About 500 years ago, a man by the name of Hernando de Soto descended right here. And behind me is the bridge that's named after Hernando de Soto. And we're going to start to tell you about Memphis, Tennessee by starting with the history of who Hernando de Soto was. Now, from the standpoint of history, we can go to the year 1540. And there was, again, there was Hernando de Soto that came to the Mississippi River. He's the first white to come to the Mississippi River. That is a phenomenon. In fact, that's what you call appearance. He appeared, he had a nature, and there was an entity to him coming. Hernando de Soto was a conquistador. This man was a conqueror. When he came to Memphis, which was not called Memphis at the time, but when he came to Memphis, his idea was to come and conquer the people and take the land. Later the French came. Later the British came. Now, let's go back to 1818. Now, there is something in history you should understand. It's called the Jackson Purchase. Again, what is it? It's called the Jackson Purchase. You know, remember when you used to see The Godfather, right? And in The Godfather would make you a deal that you can't refuse. Remember that? Do you know what it's like to have one of these Godfather deals that you can't refuse? Well, Andrew Jackson was the seventh president of the United States of America. He was a wealthy slave owner. Very wealthy. He made his money through slavery. Now, prior to 1818, this guy went to Georgia and fought the Seminole Indians and defeated them, killed them. He knew how to take care of business because he knew how to kill the Native Americans. Now, by the time we come up to 1818, this dude went and made a deal with the Chickasaw Indians who was living in his land. Now, you said, what does this have to do with us today? It has a whole lot to do with us today. That is the appearance, the nature, the entity, the power, the influence, the inherent cause, the relationship, the latent effect, the manifest effect, the consistency of beginning to the end. These are the 10 aspects. Now, when you go back to Andrew Jackson, and we go back to 1818, Andrew Jackson cut a deal with the Chickasaw Indians. That means all the way from Kentucky, the Ohio River, all the way to the west of the Mississippi River, rather east of the Mississippi River, they bought this land. Now, let's come back to 1819. We come back to 1819. Now, in 1819, Andrew Jackson, his secretary, whose name was John Overton, and a guy by the name of Winchester, they came on the Mississippi River. And they named it Memphis after Memphis, Egypt on the Nile River. So now there we are. We come up to this time in history. Now, how does that relate to me? Who is an African American? How does this relate to me? What Andrew Jackson did in 1819? Well, in 1819, he established Memphis. But what was the nature of Memphis? The nature of Memphis, Tennessee, was cotton. So now what does that entail? It entails that if you set up a city, and this city is designed for cotton, then that means you got to get somebody to pick and chop this cotton. Now, that's where my ancestors come in. Now, that a lot of African Americans, they said, my people are from Mississippi, my people are from Arkansas, and my people are from Tennessee. Well, actually, when you really do a study of history in this area, there are no Africans from Mississippi, Tennessee, and Arkansas. Young people didn't come from here. In 1818, this land was inhabited by Chickasaw Indians. Now, he said, man, I done bought this land. This is mine. We own this. So he came down and named it Memphis, Tennessee. Now, we come to about 1826, and they incorporate the city. Now, there's Andrew Jackson, a wealthy slave owner living in Nashville, Tennessee. This guy was very wealthy because he cut a deal and he owned Memphis, and they set this whole deal up, and eventually Andrew Jackson became the president of the United States of America. Now, I mean, that's a pretty powerful position for a slave owner to be in. Here the guy got this land, got this place called Memphis. He's the president of the United States of America. Oh my goodness. Now, Andrew Jackson had another thing in his mind. He had another thing in his mind, and even before 1818, he had always worked on another plan. Now, we today talk about ethnic cleansing. And we talk about how bad ethnic cleansing is. Well, Andrew Jackson always had a plan for ethnic cleansing. He said, what I am going to do, and what he struggled to do, is let's get rid of the Native Americans. Even though the Chickasaw Indians, the Choctaw, and those Chuckalissa, they were peaceful people. They wasn't bothering anybody. They could live in this land. But in 1830, Andrew Jackson and his southern buddies lobbied, and they fought, and they came up with a law called the Indian Removal Act. That is, Andrew Jackson and the United States of America, all the Native Americans from the East, all the way to the Mississippi River, had to be forcibly removed. Now, what this man did affects us today. In 1830, they took the Native Americans, and it was a caravan. They shipped all of these people, and when one of the Indian chiefs got to Little Rock, Arkansas, he started to cry. He said, this is a trail tears. This man cried because all of their ancestors being here, living here for thousands and thousands of years, the Native Americans, they had to, like cattle, they took fire boats and put them across the Mississippi River, sent them to Arkansas, and sent those people all the way to Oklahoma on a reservation. Now, what did Andrew Jackson do after that? And what did they do? They did, in turn, brought in all the slave owners. So now those guys that come from North Carolina and South Carolina and Virginia, then all the slave owners came and they brought slaves with them. And the nature of Memphis, Tennessee was white gold, cotton. Now, you said this does not have anything to do with you? Oh yes it does. If you believe that Andrew Jackson did not have anything to do with you today, then you sadly mistaken. African Americans are. Memphis, Tennessee, or the place that Andrew Jackson founded, became the slave capital of the world. Did you hear me? Memphis, Tennessee, the land that was started by Andrew Jackson, was the slave capital of the world. Many people know that Memphis was the cotton capital. How could you become the cotton capital of the world without becoming the slave capital of the world? Now, Dr. Martin Luther King upset many people because he had a courage to stand and fight, and he was causing others to stand and fight. Now, if you think that it has nothing to do with you, you're sadly mistaken. Now, when you begin to read and you begin to study, they wanted to kill Dr. Martin Luther King. They wanted to assassinate him. Now, this is 1968. Now, what city in America? What is the ideal city in America? What is the city that had the consciousness, that had a government to go and kill this man? It was Memphis, Tennessee, the cotton capital of the world. Dr. Martin Luther King was our king, but Dr. Martin Luther King came into King Cotton. Now, Memphis, Tennessee, the land that Andrew Jackson started, and I want to show you something. A lot of times, you don't think about it. Now, look at that. Look at that. Now, when you look at that $20 bill, that's them Andrew Jacksons. That is the guy who sent all those Native Americans, who ethnic cleansed all the Native Americans. He is the guy who started Memphis, Tennessee. Let me begin to bring this thing home and tell you what it means. Just as I walk around the community and I look at so many people in the eyes, and I look at the African American community, and the brother got his pants hanging down his ass, and people have a sense of hopelessness. They don't have no future. They didn't get the education. They didn't get the background. No one taught them things. They're living life on their instincts. They're so sad that they feel they gotta go take a drug. They gotta immerse themselves in alcohol, immerse themselves in illegal act or immoral activities. Come in the community, because we need somebody who can come in the community, who can stand shoulder to shoulder with his brothers. You don't know what it is when you get stopped and frisked. You don't know what it is when the police stop you. You don't know what it is to go through discrimination all of your life. You don't know what it is. In the book Native Son, it was Bigger Thomas. Bigger Thomas said in the book Native Son, he said, the imposter dream has been beaten out of me. Because I don't have the imposter dream, I don't want to tour no more. And what happened to so many of our young people? They didn't get it in school. They didn't get it together. And all of a sudden, they don't have no life no more. They find themselves in the correction centers that's making profit. You go downtown in Memphis, Tennessee, and you look at the court system, and nothing but African Americans, hundreds and thousands all in the court. You said, do white people do bad things? Why is it that we are only a small percentage of the population, but yet we probably have 50-70% of African Americans in the jail system? Something is wrong with that. Something is wrong in America. You develop an inner strength. So once you develop the consciousness, once you develop the inner strength within yourself, then you begin to get a power within yourself. You begin to get an understanding. The debt that's stacked against you. Now, your fathers and grandfathers and great-grandfathers did not come up to leave you anything. They made other people rich. When you walk around Memphis, Tennessee, or you walk around throughout America, the Africans don't own the assets in America. Booker T. Washington, in his book Up From Slavery, said, we, who as African people, missed 100 years of an industrial education. So we didn't have an education. We growing up and we developing something and we building industries. We didn't have this kind of education. So he set up schools called A&I schools, Tennessee A&I, Agriculture and Industrial, Florida A&M. We had agriculture and mechanics because they understood, they were enlightened. But I'm going to close with a story that you know about. And this kind of takes you to Buddhism. Nelson Mandela, a man who they put in prison for 27 years. Nelson Mandela looked inside himself and he said, when I left that prison, I left it. And if I came out of that prison with anger, then I would be in the prison forever because I learned how to forgive. He brought himself up. However, inherently within every human being, there is a bodhisattva nature. There's a nature to do good, to help others. You are more higher than you are Lord. And when you change yourself, you can change others. So just like Nelson Mandela, who reached inside himself and brought peace to his country, we can make a better America. We can help ourselves. We can help our brothers. We can help our sisters. We can make a better America. But it's got to be us. So I'm going to close this lecture by saying, whatever dreams you got, whatever goals you got, you don't have to be angry. You can be able to chat, and you can be able to study, and you can be able to understand history, and you can get peace in heaven is in this life and good circumstances in the next. And no matter what your circumstances are, you don't have to do the drug. You don't have to go out and rob nobody. You don't have to kill nobody.